You can see here a measurement setup for measuring conducted emissions. Our test object is located on the left of the table. This test object is usually called device under test, or DUT. Our DUT is supplied with 230 volts via a standardized network replica. The current term for that replica is Line Impedance Stabilization Network, or LISEN. With the help of that LISEN, we can measure the emissions using an EMI receiver. At the same time, we can supply our DUT with the help of an isolation transformer. This block diagram describes the measurement setup. The 230 volts from the transformer pass through the low-pass filter of the LISEN and reaches the DUT. The DUT itself now causes conducted emissions, which are decoupled via the high-pass filter of the LISEN. These emissions are then measured with an EMI receiver. By the way, this setup is not built in a random way, but attempts to meet the CISPR 16-2-1 standard as good as possible. This standard already specifies quite precisely how our measurement setup should look. I drew this picture myself, but it is quite similar to the one that you can find in the standard. From left to the right, you can see again DUT, LISEN, and EMI receiver. Our DUT is a switched mode power supply. This converts a 230 volts AC voltage into a 5 volt DC voltage, like those that might be built into a PlayStation or a desktop computer. An important customer would like to buy our product in just a few weeks. The tower here is just our test load. We could adjust the load, but in our experiments, we let flow 1 amp all the time. The first measurement you should always perform is a measurement without any load. So what we see here is just ambient noise. The yellow and blue lines are our measurement results, measured with two different detectors, quasi-peak and average. We will explain everything in detail in a later video, don't worry. The important thing for now is, the x-axis shows the frequency, the y-axis the interference level. The yellow and blue lines must each be below the corresponding red limit line. If this is not the case, we are not allowed to sell our product. So let's plug in our DUT and let's measure our product. This clacking only means that an internal relay is switched all the time to control the attenuator so that the measured signal is not clipped. Anyway, we're clearly above the legal limits, which is why we are not allowed to sell our product as it is. Since time is running out as our product is being prepared for sale, we don't have many options left to improve our DUT. The most promising measure now is filtering. So let's try to add an X capacitor to suppress differential mode noise. Maybe we will be lucky and thus have solved our emission problem. Obviously, the filter didn't help us much. So, have we failed and will we lose our customer? Not yet, because we haven't dealt with common mode filters yet. Therefore, let's put in two Y capacitors. These should be as identical as possible so that we don't accidentally convert common mode problems into differential mode. Let's hope that this has made a difference, hopefully a positive difference. Yes, we managed to be below the limits. However, two peaks still cause me some concern. These are dangerously close to the limit. Therefore, I will modify the circuit one last time. I would like to try a common mode choke. This device has 4 connections, so I must install it the correct way. Let's see if the choke has done something good. Wonderful! This is exactly how preliminary measurements should look, far away from the limit. By the way, all the terms you see here will be clarified in future videos. For example, a transducer factor TDF has been set here. This corrects the result as the connected pulse limiter attenuates the measured signal by 10 decibels. Without the pulse limiter, our receiver could take serious damage when we turn on our DOT because of rapid current transients. Keep in mind that the measurement shown covers only one aspect of EMC measurements, conducted emissions. Many additional measurements are required before our product is considered electromagnetically compatible. The use of filters before selling the product should also be more of an emergency solution. If the product is designed with EMC in mind from the beginning, this really saves a lot of time and cost for possible troubleshooting.